A great idea. You know, to have a little ceremony, a little introduction to the Enterprise as the Enterprise unfolded. Now, this is a scholarly operation here, University of Maine and all the rest of it. So I feel I've got to do a little scholarly transition here to move from the original arrival to what we're going to get down to. And I thought maybe a short poem might not be inappropriate to sort of make the academic bridge. All I could see from where I stood was just three long mountains in the wood. I turned and looked the other way, and I saw an island in the bay. I turned my eye, and all I could see for where I stood was just those three long mountains in the wood over these things I could not see. These were the things that bounded me. But sure, the sky is big, I said. It's miles and miles above my head. So here upon my back I'll lie, and I will look my fill into the sky. And so I looked. And well, after all, the sky is not so very tall. The sky, I said, must somewhere stop, and sure enough, I can see the top. The sky, I said, is not so grand. I must can touch it with my hand. And reaching up my hand to try, I screamed to feel it touch the sky. Now, how's that for an opener? Right? Good. Okay. Now, I've got two or three things. That's sort of a bridge, like playing the national anthem before a ball game, you know. I had this passed out. And I think to understand what's on this sheet is terribly important. There's obviously an ordinate and an abscissa, and they're both logarithmic. The ordinate here is watts per square meter. And that's something I think is very important to know. For example, if you look down at the bottom, it says phytomass. That's a forest at the bottom. You can get forests from, they say if it's 10 square meters or smaller, don't call it a forest. You know, you got to be bigger than 10 square meters, and it'll go up all the way to thousands of square meters to be a forest. But now the energy is about from 0.5 to 1 watt per square meter. Now that's, I think, a terribly important thing to understand. If you do what foresters do, sit on a stump, wear a hard hat, and watch the trees grow, that's what you see. You see 1 watt per square meter photosynthetic activity, locking up carbon dioxide and oxygen and sunshine into a biomass fuel. That's all that's there. It is about 1 watt per square meter. Now, if you look up the line, you see, for instance, that there are supermarkets. And a supermarket is around 500 watts per square meter. So when you take your cart and move around the supermarket, your cart is about a square meter. You think of it, you and the cart about a square meter. Out there somewhere, refrigeration, air conditioning, dehumidification, lights, and all the rest of it, there's about 500 watts going on for every square meter that you occupy to operate the supermarket. Now, if you look down, you can see that photovoltaics down the line is only 40 to 50 watts per square meter. Now, what this says is, can you put photovoltaic arrays on a supermarket and run a supermarket? What's the answer? No, can't come even close. You can cover the roof with the photovoltaic arrays, and you can't come close to operating a supermarket. Now look down there for wind. Wind turbines are 4 and 5 watts per square meter. So if a supermarket takes 500 watts per square meter, how many wind turbines have you got to put out there to run that supermarket? And I keep running into this over and over again. People think they're going to put pinwheels in estuaries and run casting, for instance. I have the words across the top are periodicity, stochasticity, and dilution. Now, dilution, you understand. Dilution is the fact that there's only 1 watt per square meter in the forest. That's all that's there. If you've got some thermochemical magic by which you can convert forest biomass into ethanol, you can't do any better than 1 watt per square meter. The first law of thermodynamics says that's what it is, and that's the end of it. Now, when you look at the wind, you can see it's only 5 watts per square meter. So you can see, now that's the footprint. That's not the disc going around. That's looking down on the field. And you can't build bigger windmills. They don't help, because if you build bigger ones, you've got to spread them further apart. And it's still only 5 watts per square meter. So if you're going to do a significant job of supplying energy for a community by putting up windmills, you've got to put up enough, a lot of windmills and a lot of square meters in order to supply relatively small amounts of energy. So I think this is an important, you can keep this if you want to. If you don't want to keep it when you leave it on the table in the back of the room, because I talked to other groups, and there's no point in having you just take this and throw it away. But if you think it's important, and you want to keep it, that's fine. The words periodicity and stochasticity, delusion is easy. Periodicity is easy. That is, it means it comes and goes, solar energy and wind. The stochasticity, what does that mean? What's stochasticity? What does the word stochastic mean? Nobody wants to be. It means random. I know that 9 miles up from Manhattan Island, about 9 Mile Point, there are 2,000 megawatt nuclear plants. They supply half of the electricity for New York City. Now, I'd like to have somebody lay out a series of wind turbines that would guarantee what those two nuclear plants do. Because the wind has a periodicity. You've got to put up windmills all over the place. Then you've got to connect them by a bunch of wires to get them down to New York City so that you can run New York City reliably on wind power. Okay. Now I want to talk about the pictures that I've got here. This goes back to 1950, and it's a picture of what our energy consumption has looked like since 1950. Now we see we've got petroleum, natural gas, coal, nuclear, hydroelectric, biomass, geothermal, wind, and solar. And you can see that something happened in 1973. That is the Arab oil embargo. That's the Yom Kippur War, when the Arabs shut off the oil because they didn't like our support for Israel. Then we go up to the middle 1980s, and the middle 1980s was the Iranian hostage crisis, where again there was a big international brouhaha, and the economy slumped. Now we go on up to the present day and after the year 2000, and you notice how it's getting very flat. Tremendous growth in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And you get the year 2000 to the present, and nothing much happens. In fact, this year, the amount of electricity that is being distributed and sold is less than last year. That is, the amount of it's actually going down. The reason is the computers are getting more efficient, lighting is getting more efficient, and all the major growth has gone to China and India and Korea. We don't have big factories making big things anymore. So that the actual amount of electricity used in the United States is going down. So that the point here is that there's a flatness to the curve when you get above, say, 2010. And I've got some slides that show you a little bit later to show you what happens to the renewables. Now you'll notice over here is percent renewables. That starts out in the 1950s, it's 9% renewable. You get up to the present and it's now only 8% renewable. The reason for that is that the hydro energy is about constant. They've got Grand Coulee Dam and Hoover Dam, and they pump out so many kilowatt hours a year. And if that represents a large fraction of the total load, then of course it's a large percentage renewable. The total load grows if you don't put any more hydro stations in the system, and that means that the fraction of renewable energy goes down. So we aren't doing great things now with renewable energy. We're up to 8 or 9%, and the bulk of that is hydro. Which one do I push here?
Right arrow.
The right arrow, all right. Ah, very good. I broke the code. This is, I think, a very important picture. Down the left is all of the energy bases that we use. Petroleum, natural gas, coal, renewable, and nuclear. Down the right-hand side are all the uses of energy. Transportation, industrial, residential, and commercial, and electric power. And if you take a minute to look, what this says is, can you turn the lights down a little bit here? Thanks. Oh, great. If you look at petroleum, 70% of the petroleum in the United States goes to the transportation sector. All right. The transportation sector is made up 96% petroleum. You see how it works? Now, it's interesting that if here is renewable energy, 9% of the renewable energy goes to the transportation sector, and the transportation sector is 2% renewable. What is that, anyway? What does the transportation sector run on renewable energy? Ethanol and gasoline. That is, 9% of the renewable energy in the United States heads toward the transportation sector. When it gets there, it's only 2% of the transportation sector. And then here's that coal, 8% goes to industrial. Notice that only, almost no coal is used residential and commercial. There's less than 1% of the coal goes there. Coal is less than 1% of the resident. Nobody burns coal anymore in a residential and commercial setting. But I think this bottom one is a big surprise. When you look at the electric power generation, is 40.6 units, residential, commercial 10, industrial 21, transportation 9, almost half of the energy in the United States, 40%, goes to make electricity. Now, I think that's a surprise. I don't think we would figure on that. Now, nuclear, 100% of the nuclear doesn't go to transportation or anywhere else. 100% of the nuclear goes to electric power. Electric power is 21% nuclear. We're going to refer back to this curve. So let me give you a few minutes, or 30 seconds anyway, to think about what's on that curve. Now the units here are very interesting. The units, it says, are in quadrillions of BTUs. So that when they talk about 70% goes to transportation and so on. And when you add it up, it turns out to be about 100. You take 29, 21, 10, and 40, add those up, and it's 99 point something. Do the same thing over here. Take 39.8, take 23.6, 22.8, 6.8, and 8.4, add it up, and it's about 100. So you have about 100 units of input and about 100 units of energy use. So you can think of those as percent. You can think of 40% of the total energy used in the United States is used in the form of input to electric power plants. You can think of 29% of the energy used in the United States goes into the transportation sector. Now the unit here is in quadrillions of BTUs. Now that a quadrillion is 10 to the 15th power. Now everyone else in the world, of course, uses joules, joules, or joules, depending on what part of England you're from. And as you know, a joule or a joule or a joule is 1,000 times smaller than a BTU. So if we were to take this 15 quadrillion BTUs and we wanted to change it over into joules, instead of being 10 to the 15th power, it'd be 10 to the 18th power, wouldn't it? Because we can make the same chart with joules, but instead of 10 to the 15th, it'd be 10 to the 18th. Now, 10 to the 9th is a giga. Right? 10 to the 18th has got to be a giga-giga. And the unit is a joule. So you can convert this to giga-giga-joules, which I think is all cool. The trouble is that you look at a lot of graphs of this kind of thing, and it'll say in the border, G, G, J, giga-giga-joule. But some spoil sport has come along and says 10 to the 18th power is an exa. Now that's no fun at all. So these things are exajoules, if you want to think of it that way. That's 10 to the 18th power is an exa. But I much prefer jigga jigga. I think that goes with the territory. So is that all right with any question that comes up when you look at that graph? I think there's a lot of information there. Now you look and the data is 2007, but is there nothing much has happened? Nothing much has happened since 2007. The amount of energy used in the United States has remained about the same. What am I doing wrong here? Do I have to point it at?
No, just the right button. The right arrow.
Okay. Now this is renewable information. But it's out of date, 2009. I'll show it to you in 2009, and I have the next slide that shows it to you right up to date. Just flew in over the transom, and I brought it with me today as red-hot information. But you can see here that 37% is petroleum, 23% is natural gas, 21% is coal, 9% is nuclear, and 8% is renewable energy. Now, what happens to that renewable energy? The renewable energy is 35% hydro. It's 24% biomass. It's 20% biofuels. That's the ethanol for gasoline. It's 9% wind. It's 6% waste. It's 5% geothermal and 1% solar. That's the way the renewable energy is now metered out. This is brand new information. I just got this, and I made that slide made just for you. The U.S. Department of Energy, Energy Information Agency, has a $100 million annual budget, has a tremendous supply of scholars that work for it, publishes great big documents, and their budget and their reports all go to a committee of Congress. They don't report to the Department of Energy, so they presumably are not in any way obliged to report what the U.S. Department of Energy feels to be true. And here you start today, 2014, and they look as to what's going to happen to renewable energies. Now, up the side of the unit, the units along the side are in billions of kilowatt hours that are going to be generated by these various forms of energy. Now, we naturally use now 4,000 billion kilowatt hours of electricity is used in the United States. So if they get up to 400, 10% will be renewable. And so they might get up to 400 by the year 2020. You can see there's 300, there's 600. So 400 is in there somewhere. And the U.S. Department of the Energy Information Agency says, we don't know what the future is going to look like because we don't know what Congress is going to do. We don't know what laws are going to be enacted or anything else. So we let you decide. We'll give you the information and you decide. If high oil and gas resources are available, as we've already discovered a lot of natural gas out in the Dakotas and so on, if a lot of oil and natural gas turns out to be available, we won't get much renewables. That is, the oil and natural gas will be so available and so cheap that we won't bother to turn on the renewables. Now, if we have low economic growth, if there's a depression and there isn't much demand for energy, we won't get much increase in renewables. Now, the reference case is what they think is going to happen. That's their best judgment. But they also say if you get high economic growth, booming prosperity, everybody goes to work, big demand for energy, now there will be a subsequent demand for renewable energy because of the increased demand in overall energy. And then the low oil and gas resources. Now, if the oil and natural gas begins to peter out, you know, they can't find as much oil and natural gas, now we'll have more renewables. That's what that shows. Now, low renewable technology cost, if we get really economic sources of renewables, we'll get more of them. That's what that graph says. And the No Sunset says that right now there's a tremendous amount of subsidy for wind and solar. You know, the government will pay you all kinds of money if you put up solar systems, and they give you tax rebates and so on. Well, Congress has talked about stopping all those rebates. Well, that blue line there says No Sunset. That means Congress does not shut off the subsidies. If they keep the subsidies going for the wind and the solar, you'll get big growth in renewables. And then the next one is GHG25. Gu will be interested in this. Gu's a tenant of mine, along with a friend of his, is Lou Wong. And he was helping me put this together. And I said, no, I know what GHG is. That's his greenhouse gas. I got no idea what the 25 means. And so I just shrugged it off. Well, Lou stayed at the computer, and he thrashed around, and finally he said, $25 a tax on CO2. That's what GHG25 means. If you put a $25 tax on carbon, you'll get a lot of renewables, because the renewables don't have any carbon with them. So I have to give my tenant credit for having the patience to struggle through all this stuff to find out what the 25 meant. It meant a tax of $25 on every ton of carbon dioxide you put in place. Okay, so that's the future of renewable energy, and that goes out, you see, to the year 2040. Now, these people that have million-dollar budgets and have all the expertise that have come to the conclusion that not much is going to happen in renewable energy. By the year 2040, you're going to be up to 600 billion kilowatt-hours a year, and we use 4,000 billion kilowatt-hours a year. So that things are going to, the future is going to be pretty much like the past, if you believe the Energy Information Agency and what it is they're telling. Okay. Great. This is the personal use of energy. Now I take 100 times 10 to the 15th power. That's the quadrillions of BTUs used in the United States for all purposes. Coal, oil, natural gas, nuclear, renewable, everything is 100 times 10 to the 15th power. Now I divide that by 3 times 10 to the 8th. Then I divide it again by 3 times 10 to the 3rd. I divide it again by 3 times 10 to the 4th. And I have the number. I'm sorry I got the numbers there. I hope you'd help me do this. But the 100 times 10 to the 15th is BTU per year. The 1 over 3 times 10 to the 8th, that's the population of the United States. So I divide 100 times 10 to the 15th by 3 times 10 to the 8th. Now it's on a per person basis. Now I divide that by 3413. That is 3 times 10 to the 3rd. That puts it in kilowatt hour units. And because this is annual, I got to divide it by the number of hours in a year. And that's about 8,760 hours in a year. And I call it 10 to the 4th. I gave this presentation at a conference once. And when I presented this slide, I said there are 10,000 hours in a year. One of the other speakers got up and said, if Dick Hill can say there are 10,000 hours in a year, I guess I can say. Well, 10,000 close enough. You know, I'm not going to fuss over whether it's 8,000 or 10,000. So you put it down now in units, and it turns out to be 10 kilowatts per person. Now, that's not electricity now. That's simply measuring energy use in electrical units. It's got nothing to do with wires or electricity or anything else. So each one of us sitting in this room is responsible for, out there somewhere, in some steel mill, the university boilers or somewhere, 10 kilowatts are being used on our behalf. Now a 10 kilowatt is a rate, and I have trouble with this. I write more letters to the editor on this issue than anything else. A kilowatt is a rate at which energy is being used. A kilowatt hour is the quantity of energy. Now those are two different things. So what we're looking at here is that the 10 kilowatts is the rate at which you and I and everybody else per person is using energy in the United States. Now the energy to electricity, we go back to that 40 unit on the first slide. Remember, 40% of the 100 quads of energy goes to make electricity. Remember that slide? Well, I've got that 40 again times 10 to the 15th. That's the energy that goes to make electricity. Now I divide that by 10 to the 4th, and that equals 4,000 times 10 to the 9th. And that's where the number comes from. 4,000 billion kilowatt hours a year is the electricity generated in the United States. Now you know, there are 3413 BTUs in the kilowatt hour. Yet to do this calculation, I divide by 10 to the 4th, not 3 times 10 to the 3rd. In order to get from the amount of energy going in to make electricity to the actual electricity that is made, I don't divide by 3413, I divide by 10,000. Why is that? It's the second law! Now everybody say it. Why do I divide by 10,000? Put all together now. It's the second law. Say it again now. Why do I divide by 10,000?
It's the second law.
Exactly. When you hit a power plant and you put in all these BTUs, you don't get that much out. Because the second law is there taking 2/3 of it. So I have to divide the 40 times 10 to the 15th by 10 to the 4th. And now I get a right, that's the right answer. If you go to the all of the information about how much electricity is made in the United States, they'll say 4,000 billion kilowatt hours a year, that's it. But you're putting in 40 quadrillion BTUs goes into the enterprise that makes electricity. Okay. Now, if we take 4,000 times 10 to the 9th and divide it by 330 times 10 to the 6th, what's that, 330 times 10 to the 6th?
Population
of the United States. So that comes down to 12 times 10 to the 3rd is what the electric use is per person in the United States. In Maine, it's 11 times 10 to the 9th, 1.3 times 10 to the 6th is the population, and we're only 8.5 times 10 to the 3rd in terms of kilowatt hours per year. We don't use much electricity in Maine compared to the United States as a whole. Several reasons. Not a big air conditioning load here. Electricity is expensive here. The United States as a whole has 12 kilowatts per person. In Maine, it's 8.5 kilowatts per person. So when you think of the actual use of electricity now, that each individual in Maine is walking around with 8.5 kilowatts of electricity. Now, that's a lot. Now here's the main forest. Here again, if you do what the foresters do, what do foresters do? Sit on a stump, wear a hard hat, and watch the trees grow. Okay? I gave this presentation to a group, and somebody came up to me afterward and said, "Don't say that about foresters. We don't sit on a stump and wear hard hats and watch the trees grow." Oh, okay. But if you do that, a forester will tell you that the forest will grow about 0.69 tons per acre year. And there are about 2,000 pounds in a ton and about 8,000 BTU per pound. So you do the math and you find out that the main forest will support about 10 times 10 to the 6 BTUs per acre year. That's the photosynthesis process. That's how much they actually, this is how much you can go out and harvest in the forest. This is the rate at which forests grow. If you cut it off as it grows, you get that. So now you take the 10 times 10 to the 6th, and you divide it by 1 times 10 to the 4th to get it into annual, and divide it by 3,000 to get it into kilowatts. It turns out that you get 0.3 kilowatts per acre. Not very much. 0.3 kilowatts. See, remember now, a kilowatt, is that energy or is it a rate? Kilowatt. It's a rate, okay? So if you're sitting there watching the forest grow, and you're sitting on an acre, 0.3 kilowatts of energy is coming up out of that forest all the while. That's the rate at which energy is being produced by the forest. Okay. So now you take that, and the main forest has 17 million acres, and you take 5 times 10 to the 6 kilowatts for the main forest. Now you divide that by the population of Maine, and you get 4 kilowatts per person. That is, if we took all of the growth of the main forest and turned it into energy by some thermochemical ledger domain. I love that line. By some thermochemical ledger domain. What does the word ledger domain mean? Hocus pocus. Magic. If by some magic you could turn the forest growth into energy and divide it by the population, you get 4 kilowatts per person. And how much do we use? 10. So we can't dynamite the Kittery Bridge and make the future like the past and take the energy and that we need from Maine by just taking it out of the forest. You just can't do it. The energy isn't there. There's a lot of talk about the sequestration of carbon dioxide from coal. And here there are 2,000 times 10 to the 9th. Kilowatt hours from coal. That is, that the total now, as you remember, is 4,000 kilowatt hours a year, and about half of it's coal. Now, this slide's a little out of date because we've shifted a little more to natural gas. That 4,000 number is a little big, but not much. Now, when you take coal, if it's mostly carbon, carbon has an atomic weight of 12, carbon dioxide has a molecular weight of 44, so every 12 pounds of carbon makes 44 pounds of carbon dioxide. So I said, because coal isn't all carbon, there's other stuff in there. So I have said that if you take coal and you burn 2,000 million tons of coal, you're going to have twice that much carbon dioxide. So you got 4,000 times 10 to the 9th pounds of carbon dioxide. Well, of course, you know carbon dioxide in three forms. You know it as a gas, CO2. You know it as a solid, dry ice. Nobody's ever seen carbon dioxide as a liquid. Well, if you compress it to 1,000 pounds per square inch and you cool it, you can turn it into a liquid. Then you can make carbon dioxide liquid, just like this liquid water. But you can't make it slosh around in a bucket like water does. You got to have it at extremely high pressure in order to get it as a liquid. So if you go to 1,000 pounds per square inch, the specific volume of carbon dioxide is you're going to have 80 times 10 to the 9th cubic feet of carbon dioxide. Now, 20 times 10 to the 6th barrels of oil per day, that's how much oil we consume in the United States. Now, a barrel is about 5 cubic feet. So we use about 400 barrels of oil a day, barrels per year. I'm sorry, I mixed up. So if you're going to liquefy carbon dioxide, you're going to have to put away 40 times 10 to the 9th cubic feet per year. When we consume 20 million cubic feet of oil, so you've got to handle twice as much liquid carbon dioxide as you're already handling petroleum, and you got to handle it at a pressure of 1,000 pounds per square inch. Now, we see all kinds of petroleum sloshing around in tanks, going up and down the road. We put gasoline in our tanks, all the atmospheric pressure. Now, you got to add twice that much at 1,000 pounds. Never even going to think of doing it. Well, first of all, carbon dioxide is suffocating. That is, if there's a pipeline carrying carbon dioxide and you get a leak in it, and you get as high as 8% carbon dioxide, it reduces the partial pressure of the oxygen, people in the area will suffocate. That isn't poisonous, but you die from carbon dioxide poisoning. So these people that think they're going to continue to burn coal because we've got some way of capturing carbon dioxide and sequestering it in the ground. It's just plain absurd. You're not going to do it by any matter of means. If the technology becomes available, there's no way you're going to be able to put pipelines in the ground with 1,000 pounds CO2 in it to move that CO2 around to some place where you've got a crack in the rocks where you can put the stuff in. The sequestering of carbon dioxide is